The following message by Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark is brought to you by Full Stature Ministries and its supporters. For more information about Full Stature Ministries, please visit forgive123.com. That's forgive123.com.
Today's message is Christian counseling is fading away. Oh boy, that ought to get some emails. Probably from Christian counselors. But anyway, I believe Christian counseling as we know it is fading away. There will always be a need for financial counseling, some pastoral counseling, and pre-marriage counseling. All right. But what we commonly call Christian counseling in the church, for me, the only real candidates, and we talked about this in one of the previous, is a brand new baby Christian or someone who has gone through severe trauma and they got smacked with something. You know what? They could use some assistance and so on. But by and large, most of what Christian counseling is involving are people who've been around for a decade or more. That shouldn't be so. That's going to fade away. And how it's going to fade away? We were just talking to our publisher this week, and the next two books that we're going to do this year, one's got to be done by June 1st of this year, and The Will of God is a River, but it's also going to be in there, the training on how you can deal with Jesus yourself to a larger degree than you believe possible. Where we've been used to someone doing something to us, I believe we're going to bring a body of believers that are going to be so much closer and intimate to the Lord, they're going to go directly to Him. Do you believe that? So I believe it's fading away. Christian counseling, as you know, and if there's an awakening, the Holy Spirit's going to do so much good work in people's lives that they're not going to have a lot of the, actually, carnal questions that they have. It's intimacy with God. You can't skip it. Old-fashioned Christian counseling, as we have known it, is fading away, and it's going to be replaced by a lifestyle of abiding. You're going to go directly to Him in your heart. And actually, that was the original objection to Christian counseling. Did you know that? Decades ago, the original objection was, shouldn't we be teaching believers to go directly to Him for healing and deliverance? Why do we need counselors like the world has? I'll bet you I made somebody upset already. I didn't say all counseling. Some people need financial counseling. Some people need a little pastoral counseling, mentoring, training. That's legitimate. But by and large, deliverance for seasoned Christians? Come on. You have the anointing, and it abides within. You should be doing self-deliverance, which will be our next book. But in light of talking with our publisher, I was looking over all the books we had written to keep the vision of what we're teaching before the people. Those that are here in this room, part of Kingdom Life Church, those that are affiliated with Full Stature Ministries outside of this church, we got a little lesson ourselves while Jennifer and I went through the books, all of the books that we've published so far, and what was the intent. And that is basically the intent. We discovered the intent was to do away with Christian counseling and build such a strong, healthy relationship in Jesus that you go directly to Him. Did you know Wonderful Counselor is one of the names of God? I'd rather have that counselor than a person counselor, to tell you the truth. Not saying we don't ever need them. I'm just saying I would rather have that one. The Holy Spirit is your counselor. Isaiah 9:6 says, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Prince of Peace. That's the one we should be going to. And actually, everything we teach, person goes off on this mental tangent and they go off on this emotional tangent. We keep going, okay, but unless you go to Jesus in your heart, you're going to stay the same. Unless you go to Jesus in your heart, I don't know about that, but unless you go to Jesus in your heart and deal with that, you're going to remain the same. Isn't that more like the shepherd herding the sheep and pointing them to Jesus, but it's Christ in you, the hope of glory. Not always the anointed one is going to do something to me. That is traditionally the major emphasis. Joe Heavy Speaker does his thing to you, and that will always exist. But you know what? Where it should be existing the most is in the conversion. It should be evangelistic rallies where you're converting the unbeliever. We were told to go into all the world and make disciples, but not just convert them, disciple them. But how can you disciple them? You can maybe, there's people that can win people to the Lord and don't know what to do with them afterwards. This is where we need the training. So here's what we saw. When Jennifer and I met, we weren't married. We were in an intercessors group of 90 people. You've all heard this story. 90 people, a woman had an emotional meltdown, writhing on the floor, and everybody stared at her. 90 people. This is Brownsville, Jacksonville, Morningstar. These were trained intercessors. But what did they do with a person that was having a meltdown? Nothing. And Jennifer saw, she saw me kneel down in a matter of a few minutes, get her delivered, healed. Actually, we cast down mental strongholds, emotional healing, and deliverance. There was some more deliverance later on that was kind of amusing, but anyway. But Jennifer, with her all of her training in Christian counseling, and I mean all the schools of Christian counseling, there are various schools, and in all of the schools of Christian training, she looked down and said, 5-10 years, right there on the floor. That's the attitude of the church. It's wrong. It's that attitude was developed by experience. Right? How many know people that went for help over and over and over again, and they're still the same? I've never known that. In all the years of ministry, I've only seen people that wanted to change, and got all excited about it. How many here got excited about what we taught? You saw it worked. Okay. But I can go anywhere else and find people that are already pretty much, I call brainwashed. You're already brainwashed that this is difficult, this is hard, and it takes a long time. Because that's what they saw. They formed the theology by what they saw. Don't form your theology based on what the devil has gotten victory in. Put your faith in that God is greater. Greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world, and that God is a redemptive God, and he didn't mean for that stuff to last forever. Some brainwashing means we need to have our brains washed clean. That's a good brainwashing, to where the word of God that you're, says Titus 3:5, by the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Spirit. That's a good washing. But you can't wash the brain until you start from the spirit and deal with the toxic emotions that are down there. So here's what Jennifer and I discovered just this week. We saw that Christian counseling is fading away. What Jennifer saw me do, she said, this is huge. Her impression was 5 to 10 years of counseling right there on the floor. She was really manifesting. She had everything. So she thought. She didn't have half of the stuff she said she had. And once we pulled those lies down, there was a countenance change. She was on her feet and she was doing fine. But here's what we saw. Deep Relief Now, that book, is basically birthed out of what Jennifer said. This is huge, but she only saw in part. She didn't see the big picture. I want to deliver to you today the big picture of where this is going. She saw one tiny thing, and church people will see one tiny part, even if it's legitimate. You know what she saw? Forgiveness, the way Dennis ministered to it, was instant. That was new to all of her teaching. Instant. She knew forgiveness could be a hard thing, and you might have to do it about 50 times before it takes. Her revelation of forgiveness was a part of the revelation, but that was by no means the whole truth. There are many, many people that even when we've ministered in other people's churches, that's the part they see. That worked. Forgiveness. When you do it from the heart, Matthew 18, not from the head. Believe it or not, most Christians forgive from the head and wonder why it didn't take. and then they have to do it over again, then form a theology that it must be difficult. If you do it right, it's instant, just like salvation. When you opened your heart, and you didn't even know what you did, but you opened your heart to Jesus at the point of the new birth, and you received him, you said, "Forgive me my sins." It was instant. You didn't have to work at it. It's no different. It was instant then. It's instant in sanctification. Restoration, maturity, that's a process. But forgiveness is instant. And Jennifer said, that's huge. And she only saw the tiny particle of what this is all about. Because what I'm seeing is that even preachers and teachers that are calling, saying they're giving you the how-tos, in every case that I've watched anyway, they are naming the tools. They're not telling you how to use the tools. They'll say, well, you need the Word of God, the Holy Spirit, the blood of Jesus. You need the name of Jesus. You need to confess. You need to repent. That's naming the tools. That is not breaking it down like Jennifer insisted I did for her. That the blessings of people around the world that are reporting changed lives and have been church for 20, 30, and 40 years, and they're suddenly, they caught it. And what they caught significantly was we're telling them not to name the tools. Well, you need to confess. You need to proclaim. You need to pray the word. You need to use the blood of Jesus. Don't you know that by now, most of you? You already know what the tools are. Show me how the tools work. Don't hand me a toolbox and say, name the tools for me, and then expect me to know everything. That'd be like taking toolbox and putting it in front of someone who never did plumbing before and say, okay, now fix the plumbing in this big building. There's the tools. This is a wrench. This is a pipe wrench. That doesn't mean they know how to do it, does it? This is what we saw with our books that's going to bring people from counseling, which is fading away, into intimacy with God. That deep relief now, that first book, emphasized that forgiveness is instant. It's not a process. It cleanses the heart. It washes out toxic emotions and replaces it with peace. But Jennifer only saw a tiny particle. Receiving forgiveness instant at salvation, but we asked him to come in, and when we asked him to forgive at salvation, what was the first thing you noticed? Peace. And don't tell me you can't feel nothing. You felt peace because most of you said thank you. You didn't say thank you to something intellectual. You said thank you because there was a supernatural exchange that took place and you had the assurance of your salvation. You actually received something and you said thank you. Thank you is the automatic response for a supernatural transaction. Now, the part that Jennifer didn't see at that time, although she came alive with Colossians 2:6, she said, as you received him, so walk the same way. And she went, oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. The same way I got saved, asking Jesus to come in and forgive me my sins, and it was instant. And how did I know? Because I had peace. If there's no peace, you didn't do forgiveness right. And she says, as you received him, walk the same way. Well, then what we would have to do, and this is deep relief now, and this is what we call first step to anyone that says, there's something to this, I got to find out more. We say, get first step. Get deep relief now, get the CDs, and learn how to do this in a granular fashion. She said, oh, wow, as you received him, walk that way. So that means in my day-to-day walk, anything that comes between me and Jesus, through forgiveness, I remove it and get my peace back. And even then, she didn't see the significance of peace. She simply saw it's not as hard as I thought. So the whole first particle of the revelation is, this is not as hard as you think. It's not as hard as you've been making it. And quite frankly, a lot of Christian counseling is so complicated, you couldn't minister it to children. They wouldn't understand the terms. If you've got to have that complicated of a terms, I say we return back to the simplicity that's in Jesus. Because that can be understood at any age and any intellectual level. I know people have read Christian counseling books and they go, there's too much science and there's too much psychology and I can't. Well, just It's because we've, even if there's some legitimate patterns and principles in there, so what? Do it. Don't study the patterns and the principles. You could spend a lifetime doing that. Jennifer was a school psychologist, and she would use the DSM manual. It's this thick. You know what it does? It analyzes everybody's problems. It's kind of short on solution, but it gives you a real good word study on problems. I'm saying, it was so much easier to say, Jesus, whatever that is on the inside of me, that yuck, go to that yuck and take that yuck out and restore my peace with you. You don't have to have a DSM manual. Now, here's where, after she saw, as you received him, you can walk in this forgiveness. That was deep relief now. And what she saw there was that forgiveness instantly washes out the toxic emotions, but replaces with the fruit of the Spirit. So it's not like absent, nothing. Peace. You should be able to feel the peace of God as a believer. When you don't feel the peace of God, you've got something else in the way. That something else in the way is coming between you and God. And God gave you, not Joe Heavy Speaker, the tools. He gave you the tools. And I love the message because I memorized the scripture from the King James or New King James. That's what I was pretty much weaned on, where it says the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations, arguments, high things that imagination that exalts themselves against the knowledge of God. Knowledge of God in your spirit. Arguments, high things. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal. So what are they then? Supernatural. And the message explained it in a way that we've used it in all our training manuals, because you need to hear it this way. We use our powerful God tools. That got our attention. I said, all the people that say, well, you've got to confess the word, you've got to pray the word, you've got to decree, declare, you need to have the blood of Jesus, you need to repent. You're still naming the tools. You're not telling me how to apply the tool. And what we saw here in this scripture says the weapons of our warfare are powerful God tools, smashing warped philosophies, the warped philosophy that needs smashed even now in this church and those watching by Ustream, is that the world is basically going to hell in a handbasket. Much of that is tapping into what the enemy wants you to believe and impose fear on you in society. Greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. You're supposed to be knowing what God is doing and praying against that stuff instead of succumbing to that stuff. That's a God tool. The God tool is you're supposed to be releasing loving intercession, pushing back the powers of darkness, not worried about what darkness is going to happen and woe is me, and I better stockpile food right now. That's going to rub some people the wrong way, but I'm sorry. You should be, instead of all that fear-mongering, you should be saying, how am I part of the solution? As you received him, so walk. But listen to this. Tearing down barriers that have been erected against the truth. This is what your God tools, this is what you have an anointing that by, this is what you're supposed to be doing. You're supposed to be working with supernatural equipment, intercessory prayer, that you tear down barriers erected against the truth. And I'm going to be blunt here. I went with Jennifer and I were just married a couple years back in 2000, right? We got married in 97. 2000, we went to a conference, well-known speaker saying, I'm telling you people, Y2K is going to be worse than you think. And I told Jennifer, I'm sorry, I feel fear on what he said, and I'm sorry, I can't be missing God that much. I don't care if he's a big name. The point is, they make mistakes, and the point is, they give in to fear. And they'll even tell you, don't be afraid. And I feel fear coming from them because they know that telling you not to be afraid is the Christian thing to do. But in reality, they're tapping more into what the enemy is doing, and we are to discern the devices of the enemy. But you don't own that as the will of God. That's where the problem lies. You don't receive it as inevitable. You receive it as a device of the enemy. And prophets fall for that all the time. All the time. Too many. And most don't apologize when they're wrong. I'm saying that the weapons of your warfare is to stand as an individual believer, and you got to have your own know-so. You need to put many words on a shelf and seek God himself for you. And we, when it says we use our powerful God tools, this wasn't meant for apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors. This was meant for the priesthood of the believer. This was meant for every believer. You have the same weapons. You have the same God tools. They're supposed to smash warped philosophies, tearing down barriers erected against the truth of God. Even political correctness, quite frankly, is a spiritual entity, and that's even being torn down. I love it. Because instead of getting afraid, rejoice that the enemy's being exposed. There's things now that are so clearly being exposed. I rejoice that it's being exposed. Other people are getting afraid of what's exposed. I'm saying, I love it. Pulling back. Because you're aware of his devices. And when God exposes the enemy, it's not an opportunity for fear. That's an opportunity for you to intercede. Perfect love casts out fear. Come on, it doesn't get any simpler than this. Then you should be interceding out of the love of God and excited in the midst of whatever is being exposed instead of running from what is exposed. I know that's easier because the 10 spies did it, but it says Joshua and Caleb had a different spirit. I'm more concerned that you have a different spirit. It's not about the reasoning mind. It's not about the facts. It's about a different spirit that's going to triumph, because the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. We have these God tools that smash warped philosophies, tear down barriers that are erected against the truth. Now listen to this. This is all of our modules combined in super simple second grade level. The next statement, fitting every loose thought, emotion, and impulse, that's your will, into a life shaped by Jesus. Everything we're teaching is that. How to bring the thought captive, how to bring the emotion subordinate, how to bring the will yielded to Jesus Christ as Lord. We're basically teaching lordship. But I'm going to get to that. What Jennifer saw in that first initial was just a revelation of forgiveness. And I'd say there's even churches and pastors that when we preached and taught, they caught it, but they saw forgiveness. They saw inner healing. That is extremely limited from what we're doing, because forgiveness washes out the toxic emotion and replaces it with supernatural peace. And he's the spirit of truth. He does not put peace on a lie. He ain't going to play charismatic prophetic games. If you've got peace in your heart, you've got the rule of Jesus. Not just Savior, he's Lord. When you have peace in your heart, he's Lord. I'm tired of people who claim him as their Savior, but he's not Lord. Many will say to me, Lord, Lord, you can move in the gifts. Savior and Lord are different. It's easy to invite him in. It's going to take a quality pursuit of him, an intimate relationship, to keep him Lord. And if you don't believe me, jump way ahead to the next book, Peace. Because the Peace book has a challenge, and I've seen some of the most sincere, mature Christians struggle with the Peace book. Because the Peace book has a fivefold ministry of peace test in it. On a daily basis, how much was he Lord during the day as the ruler, apostolic? Did he rule in your jurisdiction? Did you go to work and rule? Did you go to work in the midst of unsaved people? Were you a light in the midst of darkness? Did you maintain your peace in the midst of chaos? Because peace swallows up chaos if it's the real thing. I'm not talking about denial. I'm talking about supernatural peace. Now, the peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you, not as the world gives to you, Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. It's very clear that the peace I'm giving is supernatural, and he himself is our peace. So it's the person of the Lord himself. But the peace that I give you, I do not take it back. You lose your peace, you lost it. You chose another system. He never removes his peace from you, regardless of external circumstances. You lose your peace when you give in to the external person or situation. So Jennifer basically saw that what she was experiencing for the first time, because she was like a yo-yo at first. We'd be sitting in the car, nobody saying anything, and all of a sudden the car would flood with anxiety, which is a form of fear. Not even a word spoke. I'm going, Jennifer, what are you thinking? She goes, I just wonder how I'm going to move all the boxes and still we're going to travel and then we're going to... Well, that's exactly what you're putting in. There's no anointing on worry. There's no anointing on fear. It's the opposite of being with God. And some think it's noble. I know people, they think it's love because they're worried for you. That ain't love. If you're really worried about me, release loving intercession. Do something constructive in the spirit. Worry is not a virtue. So, and then we asked the kids over at Morningstar, what was it, third graders? Who gave you toxic emotions? The devil. We asked that to adults and they have to think about it. How do you explain that? Where did toxic emotions come from? Hurt, fear, lust, anger, guilt, shame. Where'd that come from? The devil. I mean, in unison. Adults, they go, God help us.
I just did that in Baltimore. It was funny.
Yeah, we did it. Well, we don't go there. Yeah. But we saw adults not know the answer. Mm-hmm. And so the second book, what Jennifer discovered was that the real test was the supernatural peace of God, and that the kingdom, what we're preaching is kingdom, because the kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost, and righteousness is love and action. So basically we said, I said, Jennifer, that peace is God emotions. That's why you have an emotional system in your body. It was meant for the fruit of the Spirit so that you could feel his presence. As a matter of fact, you can't live without feelings. And a whole lot of people in the church are going to start saying, well, you can't live by your feelings. What do they mean when they say you can't live by your feelings? By your carnal feelings. But they're eliminating the good ones, the supernatural ones, the fruit of the Spirit. I live by the supernatural. I feel God's presence as a constant. And you can be trained to feel his presence as a constant and let the peace of God rule. Feel. Yep, I said that word. Feel, feel, feel. We've been brainwashed not to feel. I got the joy of the Lord because I'm a man of faith. If I was honest, I'd say I was depressed, but I can't say I'm depressed. That would be a bad confession. So I just got the joy of the Lord by faith. That is not a God tool. That is not even faith. Faith is an inner feeling of assurance, a title deed, and I've got it. I am what I am by the grace of God, and I like me. That's coming from an inner knowing of a new creation reality that the real me loves God and loves his word. That's the real me. Any part of you that doesn't love God or love his word needs to come down, pushed out, something. All right? So Jennifer saw that what I was basically showing her that went beyond forgiveness in deep relief now to the supernatural power of peace and that book. And that, here's the key, most, and you won't see this in most charismatic prophetic circles, this won't be mentioned enough, so I drive it home repeatedly. If you hear me repeat stuff, I'm not going senile. I'm doing it to turn a tide of brainwashing. Most supernatural is too quiet for your flesh. Most people only know supernatural when they get goosebumps. They have to, it has to be strong. I'm telling you, you can practice the presence of God, but you're going to have to learn to use your God tools to wean your noisy mind and your noisy emotions, wean it of its rule, and let peace rule. You've got to wean the flesh. David said in Psalm 130-something or other in the Bible, like a weaned child with its mother, I have quieted my soul within me. You have the God tools. You don't need somebody to minister to you to quiet your flesh. You have the capacity to quiet your flesh if you choose to sit still. Remember, what did he say to even Elijah, the man of power? It's not in the fire, it's not in the wind, it's not in the earthquake, but the still small voice. If it's a still small voice, he's not going to shout louder. You've got to learn to shut up and get quieter. If you don't know how to still your own mind and your own emotions, don't expect to hear from God all the time. Do you have trouble hearing from God? If you have trouble hearing from God, you have trouble being still. Be still and know that I am God. Sink, let go, let drop, and know intimately that I am there. Drop down. To sink into in order to be clothed. If you want your mind flowing with revelation knowledge that comes from down up, the peace of God will guard your heart and your mind. You sink into him so that you're clothed. And that peace will guard your mind and it'll keep some of those critters from running like roaches across your brain. They like darkness. Roaches like the dark. And they run across your brain. Is this gross or what? They like running across your brain and leaving their little footprints and crumbs. Hopefully those crumbs will take. But when you sink into him and peace guards your heart and your mind, the wisdom that comes from above is in you. And it's first of all peaceable, full of mercy and good fruit. Jesus gave us peace and he never takes it away. That has to be washed over your brain until you believe it. When you lose your peace, you lost it. You stepped away. You let a person or circumstance. Do you see how challenging this could be to a believer? But to a believer that will take up this challenge and improve gradually in it, you're not going to need counseling. You're going to be practicing the presence of God. You're going to be doing what John 15 has said all along. How come nobody's talking about John 15? Because it's too hard. What's John 15? How many know what I'm talking about? Abide in me, and my word abides in you. Apart from me, you can do nothing unless you abide in the vine. Some people think they can do something without abiding. All right? So basically what God is saying, he himself is our peace. And the real challenge on the supernatural power of peace is getting seasoned Christians. And if you're watching by Ustream and you've been in the faith for 30, 40 years, I'm really talking to you. Take the peace challenge and you'll be surprised how much he's not Lord of everyday life. The peace challenge basically says this: how much of the day did I maintain the rule of God? Not, you didn't lose your salvation. I'm not talking about Savior. I'm talking about Lord. How long during the day, any given day, was I remaining in peace? Then the second part would be from the peace rule. How many decisions did I make today from the place of peace before I made the decision? That's the rule of God. You know how most Christians make choices? When they're afraid or guilty. And it can look good. It can be the, like they say in the South here, the Christian thing to do. If the Christian thing to do came from guilt or fear, you can't justify the fruit from a bad root. If the root is fear or guilt, don't expect good fruit from it. That's why even in your giving, God loves a cheerful giver. A fearful giver is going to have to deal with that fear sooner or later. Because there's a reluctance, and that reluctance is going to trip you up. Most people knew when there was a breakthrough in giving. How many can remember when you got the breakthrough on financial giving? Baby Christian, it was hard. There was a resistance to your flesh. But once that breakthrough was there, there was a freedom and a release that became part of the rule of God. Third one, more of the evangelist. How many times at work, school, or at home did the atmosphere of other people evangelize you? How many times did you bring the peace of God into the midst of a bunch of angry people and they calmed down? That's Jesus' Lord. This is Lordship. This sound too hard? I'm talking to the 20, 30, and 40-year Christians. Is that too hard? Maybe you ought to try it. Because he doesn't take his peace away from you. It's available. You've just gotten accustomed to living by the flesh. You're saved, but he's not Lord. Don't you think we ought to increase his lordship in our day-to-day life? Do you know if we increased his lordship and you started seeing improvement in the peace walk, you wouldn't need counseling. You wouldn't need deliverance. You know why? Because the enemy can't touch the peace of God. It will guard your heart and your mind, and he can't touch somebody that's in peace. And don't do what people have tried to trick me with the discernment either. Like, you could feel lust coming from them, and they were saying, well, I've got a peace about it. I know God wants me to get that new boat. I know he's telling me to get that new boat. I got a peace about it. You're using Christianese, but there's no peace in that. You're over to go, you're almost salivating. So how could there be peace in that? The Pavlov's dog, that's right. A boat, I want a boat, I want a boat. I need more boats, I need more boats. Two boats, three boats maybe. Don't con a con, as they used to say. If you can discern, don't try to con a discerner. All right? So basically then we saw, what was the first book, basically? Teaching people how to cleanse them of toxic emotions. Peace was leading them to saying, this peace book, this peace thing is militant. This is not passive, la, 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 la. This thing will crush the enemy beneath your feet. And that's like, we really need to understand how powerful peace is. Because we think peace is, oh, la, 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 sitting on and relaxing. But peace will crush the enemy beneath your feet. And God had proven it to me even in hostile environments. Even like we did it on the Sid Ross show, they did that reenactment where a guy pulled a knife on me and I'm standing at the exit and the peace of God increased. That's pretty darn militant because in most cases I say get out of the way, especially if you felt fear. If you sucked in a bunch of fear, then you better just use adrenaline and get out of there. I sat with a man on his deathbed. He died of cancer. He had been saved only 5 weeks. And while he was laying there, the glow of God was on his face. And he was telling the doctors, the nurses, and an Episcopalian priest, he held up the Bible and he says, your whole life is between these two covers. And he said, you know what I got today? He said, if I live, I live for Christ. If I die, I go be with him. Joy of the Lord radiating from someone dying. So don't tell me it's not possible, because I've seen it as a pastor over the years. That kind of fearlessness comes from the supernatural peace of God. You can't work it up. The fruit of the Spirit. God is love. It's been poured out in our hearts by the power of the Holy Spirit. And that's primarily the supernatural power of peace. Now, live free. The third book. Live free started saying, and even when we were on Sid Roth, he basically brought up, well, what you're telling me is the same as that 16th century monk, Brother Lawrence. And I'm going, yeah. I've known that from the time I got baptized in the Holy Spirit. To practice the presence of God for me was a constant. It was not intermittent. It was a moment by moment. When you blew it, boy, by golly, my spirit knew that I was disconnected, and then I'd have to reconnect. You connect, you disconnect, but it's a forgiveness lifestyle that you get your peace back and you practice the presence of God. And Live Free, basically, when we were on Sid Roth, he even changed the title, because what do we call it? Touching God. And he says, no, it's practicing the presence of God 24/7, which was our subtitle, but he had us put the subtitle into the title, because he said, this is the essence of what you're saying. And remember, He told Jennifer, he says, and you guys can do this. He goes, I'm jealous. It's not fair. And Jennifer says, there's hope for you yet, Sid. The producers love that. But it's true. We spent some time with him up in the mountains, and he practiced the presence of God. He said, my goal is to practice the presence of God for the few days we were with them. And he did it. So it's like a believer can do what God says they can do if they give him the opportunity to really be Lord and not just their Savior. So that third book was teaching how to keep the door of your heart open and continuously releasing. What we said was, it's not only John 15:5, where abide in the vine, apart from him you can do nothing, but in a practical way, what we've taught in this church, and you should have this memorized by now, Philippians 2:13 says, for it is God who is at work in you both to will and to do. Well, if he's doing the willing and he's doing the doing, my job is to surrender and let him work. How does he work? He's like a fountain. He's like a river. It's like when you turn the faucet on, you don't try to suck the water out. It comes out under pressure, correct? You turn a garden hose on, the water comes out. He says, out of my belly will flow rivers of living water. You don't have to make it happen. You open your heart, he flows. He wills, he works. That's Philippians 2:13. But you need to be taught how to do that in everyday life. And anything that interferes is coming between you and God. Okay? That's Live Free. You can tap into the fruit of the Spirit at any time. We were standing in a meeting in Santa Rosa Beach, Florida, and Jennifer and I just looked dumbfounded because she saw that the other ingredient of what she saw in what I had taught her was basically that you can tap into the fruit of the Spirit anytime you want to. It's not a mystery. And when she saw that, we were in a meeting in Santa Rosa Beach, Florida, and Bishop Hammond was up there, and he was the one that introduced the prophetic in the early, late 70s, early 80s. And basically he was saying, the day is coming. And he says, and I'm prophesying this, the day will come when people will know how to tap into the fruit of the Spirit as easily as prophecy. And Jennifer and I looked at each other. I don't get it. That's what we're doing. Teaching people to tap into the fruit of the Spirit as easily as prophesy. There's people that can prophesy very efficiently, but they're not walking in the peace of God. I want both. Then, so the secret to abiding in the vine is learning how to stay open. And we had to teach the church that in order to stay open, they didn't know where their will was. We'd say, where's your will? Point to your will. And they'd go like this. Ah, we're going to make Jesus Lord, but you think your will is here. That's mind ruled. Your will is here. And this is what has to be stay open to God. And so then we have to teach people the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, right? These are God tools. But guess what you have to do if you're going to teach people God tools? You start with what not to do. So we had to show them the flesh tool that they've been using most of their Christian life. You know what flesh tool they use most of their Christian life? You see somebody coming in the grocery store, Walmart, I like Walmart. You're coming down Walmart, and the last person on the face of the earth you want to see face to face is coming right at you. Right down here, you go like this. Right? You put up a wall. That's carnal. It's self-preservation. It's self-protection. You just shut the door on God's face and said, I'm going to take care of this with my wall of fear. Oh, guess what? That wall of fear, that belongs to the enemy. So guess what? He likes it when you put up a wall of fear because that's his doorway. You're giving place to the devil. A wall of fear, that's self, that's his door. So you think you're protecting yourself and you're giving, kick me now. And that person says, well, I fired you last week. I should have fired you a month ago. All of that yuck, all of that hurt, all of that pain, all of the toxic stuff on that person's words goes right through the door of fear, because fear is the devil's door. Fear is the devil's kingdom. But if you were to drop down to Jesus and say, oh, look who's coming down there, Jesus. Really, just Jesus, and peace would guard your heart. Anything that person said, you would feel the fiery darts, but they would not penetrate. And you wouldn't lose sleep over it unless later you hashed it out in your head over and over and over again. Which usually you come up with dumb conclusions. It's like the mother that told me she stayed up all night worrying about those kids of mine. I don't know what I'm going to do with those kids of mine. And she, sleep deprivation is a form of torture. She said, I don't know what I'm going to do with those kids. By the time she woke up, I'm going to kill those kids. Tell God they died. Does that sound like wisdom? No, that's what you come up with. That's the kind of rationale you come up with when you're left to yourself and God's not included in it. I'll just bury those kids in the backyard and tell God they died. That's a Christian thing to do, huh? And the last book so far is Releasing the Divine Healer, because then Jennifer got an even bigger picture when we traveled to churches. People were removing the toxic emotions. They were forgiving people the proper way that they should have. They said they forgave them or tried to forgive them for years. That's a telltale sign. If you're trying to forgive somebody for years, I guarantee you're not doing it right, because it's instant when it's done right from the heart. Tiny little verse of scripture in Matthew 18 can make all the difference. Doing it from the head and doing it from the heart. Unless you forgive from the heart, nothing's going to happen. And you got to know your Bible heart's down here where the seat of the emotions is. It is not the blood pumper. Jesus did not come into the blood pumper. He came into your Bible heart, the belly, the bowels, the gut, whatever you want to call it, the womb in older translations. When he came in and you've got peace, he's ruling and he's guarding your heart and your mind. But then Jennifer saw with her own eyes that we would go church to church. A number of people would get physical healings after they forgave someone. They weren't even asking for the physical healing. And it was happening again and again. And this last book was showing how we pray for better health. We are in better health in our 60s than we were in our 40s. And some cases, Jennifer had some instant ones. But for the most part, on a daily basis, for a few minutes, we close our eyes and welcome Jesus the healer who lives in me to flow to every cell in my body, every system and every organ. It's like soaking. That term came up later on, but that's the way I prayed. Until I had something to say, I didn't pray the word. I didn't pray the word till I had a word. I didn't try to make something happen. God was the initiator. And I would get in his presence and feel his presence, his nature, and then the words that were quickened or rose up out of the scriptures, those things, then I prayed that. I wanted to pray Jesus' prayer request, not getting Jesus to listen to mine. There's a difference. You're partnering with him. And it's his plan, his purpose. Sometimes we lose sight of that. We think he's there to serve us. We're here to serve him. It's about him, not about us. Some don't like that, but that's really the way it is. So releasing the divine healer then showed how the healing flowed, that you might see better health in general and healing when you remove the toxic emotions. And the primary statistic that this is laid out in the natural, is the CDC says 90% of physical ailments in your body, 90%, is that good enough portion? 90%, this is secular organization, CDC, 90% are emotionally based. And what we're teaching you is a lifestyle of removing toxic emotions. What I'm glad about is these children learning to do this at a young age aren't going to see the same kind of health problems that our generation has seen. But it's never too late. God can restore the years the locust has eaten. Deal with your emotional baggage. And in a very short period of time, that's why we have the 60-day challenge. The 60-day challenge is just a starting place for you to have a lifestyle. You don't end in 60 days and say, I've arrived. But in 60 days, you should have learned enough of how the cleansing power of God can work in a short period of time to remove the vast majority of the baggage. And health and healing are going to surprise you. Even to the point that when you get sick, you're going to see suddenly you're getting healthier quicker. Now, the Lord's giving me a word of knowledge right now that as people are beginning to practice this, allergies are going to go, particularly allergies to poultry, anything with feathers, all right? If you would receive some self-forgiveness, I don't know who this is for, but if you would receive self-forgiveness, your immune system will cooperate with what you believe in your heart. Not just saying the right answer, but really welcoming Jesus the Forgiver to forgive you for all those self-judgments. You'd be surprised how your immune system is going to kick in and remove allergies in general, but I'm seeing specifically to poultry. We've had that happen in New England, right? As well, we saw a man who couldn't handle chicken. And then he got healed after he prayed an emotional healing. But I'm seeing it now. That was years ago. The next two books. Yeah, not just physical healing, but the miracles. Miracles started rising up out of Jehovah Nissi. At Jehovah Nissi, you know it as our victory banner. But in reality, it's also the miracle worker. And walking in that relationship and believing for those miracles of transformation to take place, not just the healer, but miracles. And that's the emphasis of that book. And Destiny Image contacted us for two more. So pay attention, because you can see where are we going with this. We are basically saying a lot of Christian counseling, vast majority of it, is going to be done away with as the church learns to abide in his presence. The next book is that the will of God is a river, not just a blueprint, not just a plan, but that the will of God is going to be just like our friend Bill Morford said, what's missing in our translations from the Greek and the Hebrew is the word continually. Everything in that Bible should be a continual flow, not choppy little rules and regulations, but a flow as an attitude of the heart, a disposition of the heart that flows. Read the Beatitudes, read the Proverbs. All of those talk about a flow, not a one-time thing. Wisdom is the principal thing. That's the application of the flow of knowledge. Wisdom is how to do the knowledge. And I believe God is bringing back to the church wisdom. And the will of God, it's going to be the anointing of even what we're teaching. In order to teach people to abide, they're going to need the wisdom of application, or what we're calling the God tools. They're going to have to learn how to do it, not just what to do. Almost every believer I ever ran into knows what to do. Doesn't mean they're doing it, does it? But they know what the Bible says. It's not about knowledge. It's about wisdom of application. How does that knowledge work? How does the reality of that word flow through me so that it's like trust in the Lord with all of your heart? Lean not on your understanding. Acknowledge him through divine intimate connection, and he will direct your path. That's a flow like a river. It's not just a plan. It's not a blueprint. It's not just a place. It's a flow, and it's anointing. That's the next book. And the book after that, Self-Deliverance. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we have material on it now, but it's going to be expanded into a real book where we're going to give a lot of the... Because at that point, after they've understood and they're walking in personal biblical responsibility, then it's time to talk deliverance. You know why we save that for last? Self-deliverance. And that's not even somebody doing deliverance to you. It's you learning the difference between flesh stuff and demonic is because the tendency in the church is to look for the easy way out and blame everything on the demonic and never take personal responsibility for their emotional condition, their spiritual condition. And your spiritual condition cannot advance beyond your emotional state. You cannot be more spiritually mature than your emotions allow you. The emotions control the thinking. The emotions control the choices. Emocognition, emovolition. If you can't deal with the emotions, then you're going to fall into the trap of just running from place to place getting deliverance. If you've been saved for 10 years or more, you shouldn't be having to get, I know it's necessary for some because they don't know how to do it. But what we're saying is that's going to fade away. You're not going to have to run for deliverance to everybody. You can do it yourself, right? You should know good. You have an equipment in here. You have an anointing that knows good and evil, truth and error. Then start taking personal responsibility to not accept something that is error or unclean. Know the difference. Are we ready? You ready for those next two books? Are you walking in the previous ones? Can you see a pattern? Because that's the big picture. What I'm trying to give today is the big picture of all the books, how they fit together, what is the essential ingredients of all of them, and where we're going. Where we're going is that Christian counseling is going to fade away. Quite frankly, for a small church like we have here, we basically have healthy people. Have you noticed that? Seriously. We have healthy people. I've trained other churches, and they have healthy churches. But you can go to other churches, and my goodness, the pastors are quitting at the rate of Ministries Magazine said 96%. 96% burned out because they know their Bible inside out and backwards, and they might be living great lives, but they don't know what to do with people and their issues. And I'm saying that's easy. Teach them to deal with their own issues. They have an anointing. It abides within. They shouldn't need someone to be putting little, having little birdies come to the altar and put drop a worm in their mouth. Teach them, push them out of the nest, teach them to fly, and teach them to go get their own worms. Get into the Word of God and get your own food. Don't you think? If you're watching by Ustream and I offended you, I hope so. Because I want to afflict the comfortable. I'm speaking to the 20, 30, and 40-year Christians. Those are the ones that need a fire under them because the children are doing just fine with this. I'm talking to old wineskins that unless you change, you're going to miss some of the best things that God's doing in the days ahead. He's going to put new wine in a new wineskin. And the whining and the belly aching and all that kind of murmuring and complaining, it sure didn't get them any promises in the wilderness, did it? If it didn't work then, what makes you think it's going to work now? Right? Worry is not a virtue. You need to use your God tools and cast down those. I'm telling you, there are so many prophetic voices that see doom and gloom, and I know that I know that I know I can't live there, and I'm not in denial. I've just got so much hope in what God is telling me to do. I've got to at least do that, and that's where my joy should be. That's where your joy should be. What purpose is God telling you to do? Go do it. And if you don't know, it's because you're succumbing to your surroundings, and they're evangelizing you rather than you saying, my job is to push back the powers of all that negative stuff and be about the Father's business. Because these are wonderful days. This is the day of the saints. Bishop Hammond called that years ago. We emphasize right now the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and teachers, but they should be functioning as coaches. In reality, you should be doing the work. In reality, you should be ministering to people. And that's really what's happening with our house groups, house churches, house schools, and house outreaches. Is I'm going to be mentoring by phone at least once a month these people that have groups to troubleshoot, because where two or more are gathered, there's powerful things are taking place and you have real relationship. We need that in this church. As small as we are, we still need the house groups because you still need time to eyeball. But I've got people that I'm on the phone with on a regular basis, in some cases weekly, just troubleshooting little. I've been here for 40 years. I've done this. I enjoy it. I've not had problems that I didn't see a solution to. Jennifer was raised, even as a school psychologist, she said, in the secular realm, there's a solution to everything. Right? And you saw everything. I was a guest speaker in one of Jennifer's classes. It was a BEH class. And in God, there was a solution, and we used the God solution, and these people weren't saved. They were the ones the teachers couldn't handle in the classroom. Put them in one room. Whoa. They are bouncing off. We went in there and basically got results to the point I was a good guest speaker to those unsaved kids. Scared them, I think, but that was okay. Some of you need scared in a healthy kind of way. Right? And one by one, they couldn't do it in the group because it's too macho in a group of toughies. You can't show softness. But as soon as the class was over, they found Jennifer in the hall and were tugging on her sleeve and saying, Mrs. Clark, I have some people I need to forgive. All we taught them was sowing and reaping. And you don't have to believe in that law. Remember, what did Jennifer do? Take her pen. That's gravity. You don't have to believe in gravity, but it's going to work. Well, there's a law called sowing and reaping, and if you don't forgive, you're going to reap.
About half of that class got saved.
Half of that class got saved, Jennifer said. And they were the worst of the worst because the teachers couldn't handle them in the classroom. They put them in one room. I'll tell you what, if that can happen to them, how much more should the body of Christ start? Quit resting on your laurels that you have him as your savior and start evaluating your life by, is he Lord? Is he Lord over the seven internal thrones? Is he Lord over your finances? Is he really over Lord over your finances? You wouldn't believe how many Christians cheat on their tithe. I've been in ministry 40 years. I know. They cheat on their tithe. It's embarrassing. But they tithe. So don't tell me about the world and how evil the world is. We've got to move beyond that kind of stuff. Is he Lord over your relationships? Or do you still harbor unforgiveness towards someone, enemies? Is he Lord over all of your mind, will, emotions? Is he Lord over your body? If he's Lord over your body, you don't talk bad about yourself. You forgive yourself. You talk bad about yourself, you're asking for sickness. Oh, and not maybe immediately, but in the long haul, it's going to take a toll. God gave you an immune system to protect you. But you need to, whatever you believe in the heart speaks to that immune system. If you believe in your heart that you're a child of God and health and healing is your bread, then I'm going to keep welcoming it whether I saw results instantly or not. Most of my healings were never instant. I lived with sciatic pain that I thought I was going to have to drop out of ministry for 3 solid years. And then God healed it. But he healed it. But my attitude was, God, I'm in such severe pain. I don't know if I can minister, but I don't ever want to get crabby as a pastor because of the pain. And after I said that, don't try that as a trick. But as soon as I said that, I think he honored the attitude of the heart because it was immediately after that it got instantly healed forever. And that's 20, 30 years ago. And that was a beautiful healing. And allergies the same way. And God's going to start doing allergies. But you can't talk bad about yourself and expect to get rid of allergies. God could sovereignly, he can heal any way he wants to. He's probably taken some unsaved person and healed them. And he'll take belligerent people and heal them. But why not reduce the barriers and say, God, forgive me. Let's pray. You know what? Let's just take about 6 minutes and just soak in the answer. Abby, could you play? I think we have a tendency to rush. And I think it would be more important now if we would just say, whatever part of this message meant anything to you at all, soak in just that part. You can't soak in the whole thing. You need to listen to it again. And if you're watching by Ustream, soak in the part that triggered. When we were in Israel, some people got ministered to just by one little statement, like, most supernatural is too quiet for your flesh. And it changed lives. So whatever God was speaking to you through the message, let's soak it in for a while before we leave. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, I am well. There's a healing anointing in this room. And I'm welcoming. I'm a God welcoming. Spiritual person. watching by Ustream. You may have been busy taking notes. Put the pen and pad down and drink in and let Jesus reveal what's necessary. I want you to call the office if you're watching by Ustream and you feel like you want to be part of those groups, house churches, house schools. And if you're in this congregation and you're interested in a house group, I want you to talk to me after the service. Where two or three are gathered in my name, God doesn't need numbers. He needs hearts that are coming together in unity. Little upper rooms all around the world, bursting into flame, baptism of fire, because people have become a satisfactory witness of unity. Not perfect, but satisfactorily coming into unity. I can see a whole tsunami of people even signing up for the online school because they want to be mentored and equipped. 60-day challenge, module one. Equipping, it would be enough to equip you to at least help other people. Help your children, help your grandchildren. Start releasing that anointing to help others. God is calling for sons and daughters. He's pulling them from the highways and the byways. Like dogs that have been wounded and beat. They're hesitant. Even if you hold out a stake, they're still hesitant because they see that hand. And that same hand that's reaching out to them was also a hand that beat them and hurt them. But God's saying, I am instilling within them a drawing, a magnetic drawing. And they're being drawn to trust again. They're being drawn to open up to relationship again. And I just see people all over saying, that's me. Help me, Holy Spirit, to be more vulnerable. And to open up at some level to more trust. And as I yield to you, you will confirm in my innermost being that I'm being led by your Spirit in the days ahead. Those of you that have shied away from the corporate gathering, I want you right now to let a river of forgiveness flow out to those people. Maybe it's a person, maybe it's a whole group of people, but out of my belly flows a river of loving forgiveness because it's God who is at work in me to both will and to perform. And I'm releasing forgiveness to them. It sets me free from being controlled by that hurt or those woundings. There's a spirit of repentance in here right now. How many feel like you want to repent for this year? That you don't want to be the same person you were last year? Seriously, I'm going to welcome a spirit of repentance for internal change in my ways of thinking, feeling, and acting For the days ahead are going to be glorious days. And I don't want to be consumed by the fire. I want to be the torch. I want to be the fire that lights the hearts of other people, that inflames them and kindles an anointing on the inside. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. All that I have is yours. My spirit, mind, will, emotions, body, all my relationships, good and bad, all my possessions belong to you. And I release this in Jesus' name. Feel better soaking?
You've been listening to Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark of Full Stature Ministries at forgive123.com. Full Stature Ministries reserve all copyright protections under applicable law. Our copyright policy is available at our website, forgive123.com. For more information about Full Stature Ministries and additional life-transforming materials, please visit forgive123.com.